Yes, thanks for the introduction. Thanks all of you for joining. Welcome to my session today, which will be about developing Oracle Apex applications a little bit more conveniently, or way more conveniently, using continuous integration, continuous deployment flow, especially using Oracle Visual Builder Studio. Maybe before we dive into the subject matter, 2 seconds, 2 minutes maybe on quickly about me and my company. My name is Johannes Michler. I'm an Oracle ACE director quite recently, and I'm working for the Promatis group of companies, which has about 140 employees. We're located in 4 countries. Our main branch, which is where I'm also working for, is in Ettlingen in Germany, south of Germany. And beside of this, we have subsidiaries in some places in Germany, but also in Switzerland, Austria, and in the US. Our main focus is doing Oracle projects, doing consulting in the Oracle projects, doing consulting in the Oracle area. And we have a quite strong focus, especially on Oracle applications, both Oracle eBusiness Suite and the newer Oracle Cloud applications as well. I personally work for Promatis since 13 years now, and my main focus is especially integrating Oracle applications, mainly eBusiness Suite and Oracle Fusion, with other tools. This is one of the main things that I'm doing, but also for quite some customers, I'm doing Apex in the recent years. Where we're using Oracle Apex to extend the business applications, for example, Oracle eBusiness Suite. And this is also where the session will be today. How can we develop Oracle Apex applications more conveniently? So that brings me to the agenda. I will shortly give a motivation. What is this session about? What are the usual issues that we are seeing when developing Oracle Apex applications? How can CI/CD and DevOps help us to solve those issues? We will then have a look at the technology stack that we were using at one of our customers, maybe 3 or 4 months ago, to implement such a CI/CD pipeline for Oracle Apex. This was loosely related to Oracle eBusiness Suite, but I think 95% of the presentation today have nothing really to do with Oracle eBusiness Suite, but are very generic on how we can develop Oracle Apex applications and the underlying database schema more conveniently using CI/CD and Visual Builder Studio. And then I will show you the procedure that we used at that customer, and I will give you a short demo that shows how such a workflow can look like, how from a developer perspective, you can leverage the tools and the technology stack that I will introduce to you to really conveniently develop your Apex applications and then bring them to your testing and especially also to your production instance. And then finally, I will have some notes on what to think about if you're in an Oracle eBusiness Suite context, what is maybe special for Oracle eBusiness Suite that you may not have if you're in developing a usual Oracle Apex application. And finally, I'll have a short conclusion. So what is this about? I mean, if you're a lone developer and if you're developing an isolated Apex application and you're starting to develop from scratch, then what you usually have is you have your Oracle Apex workspace, you have some custom developed applications in Oracle Apex. You may have some database objects such as tables or some helper packages that maybe implement your business logic. Setting up such an environment for you as the developer, and maybe you're the only user of the application, is easy, right? You install an Oracle database or you get one from the Oracle Database Cloud Service, then it's even more easy. It's just a click with the Autonomous Database, basically, to get such a database. Eventually, you need to install Oracle Apex to the latest 21.2 release. If you are working with an Autonomous Database, then you don't need to even do this, and you're ready to go within seconds. Then after that, you usually start by creating your tables, eventually loading them or just creating them from scratch, developing some packages, and then import your existing application or build your application, and then you're ready to go, more or less. it's not a too complicated process, but if you have multiple developers and multiple environments, you may think about how can we automate all this provisioning of your Oracle Apex environment, provisioning of your database tables, your packages, importing your application, exporting it, having it in source code management, bringing it to a further instance. So the question is, how can we automate this? Usually, not every developer in such a case has its own instance, because instances can be expensive. But on the other side, if you have a very small environment, you can even go with one Apex instance per developer. And then you may think, why are we talking about this in 2021? I mean, having such CI/CD flows and automating the deployment and automating the building of applications is something that we are known to for, I think, 15, 20 years minimum, especially in Java area. This is how you developed your applications from the very beginning. But in an Oracle database and an Oracle Apex scope, things are often a little bit different from normal source code, be it in Java or some other libraries, that it is a little bit more complicated to keep your development environment up to date, right, and provision your environment. Usually, you are not so easily able to just start up some build processes and then just run your application, but you need to make sure your Oracle database is up and running and up to date with the latest version of your source code also. So that needs you need that makes it necessary to make sure of your database schemas. You need to think about how do you do versioning there, how can you do rollbacks in case you have any issues. And that in the end makes this overall process of developing applications often a way more manual process. Many of our customers just write some scripts that create a database or update a database to a version 2 of the schema by just running manual all the table scripts or then do some updates and then maybe having some scripts to install all the database packages. And also on the Apex side of it, usually you can quite easily just export the entire application and then you have a 500,000 lines of code moloch that you put into your version control, but it is a little bit difficult to track and keep track of and see what has really changed. So yes, it is possible, but often it is a manual process. So the session today will be, how can we automate all this? How can we automatically deploy our source code to a new test or to the production environment? How can we eventually even create a new development instance for a new project where we want to add something to our Oracle Apex application? We will have a look at what are the tools that can be helpful in this context. Especially, we will have a look at Git as our version control system of choice. We will have a look at SQL CL later on, which can be used to interact with the Oracle database. We will have a little bit a more closer look to LiquiBase, which is an open source project that helps you managing the metadata of your Oracle database to CI/CD in general. And then we may have at the end a look at some more optional or more fancy tools, especially if you're in a cloud context, where Oracle Cloud Infrastructure, OCI, can help you provisioning such environments and where you can also make use of Terraform to automatically deploy such environments. So this is what we will have a look at today, all with the overall goal to implement kind of a DevOps-like lifecycle where we have continuous integration on the left-hand side. So we develop our code, we build it, we test it, and then we release it and switch over to the deployment part of it, where we deploy it to our testing or later to our production instance. And then we operate it there, and we monitor it there, and then we plan what new changes do we want to have. And the goal of the DevOps lifecycle is to ideally automate all those steps so that it is just way more convenient to develop new versions of your applications. Yeah? By doing this, usually you have more reliable, more standardized software. You produce your builds every time in the same manner, so you can do less things wrong. And doing all this should help you having in the end way less bugs in production than you have if you have an all manual process for all those steps in the DevOps lifecycle. So that's the goal. So let's have a look at the technology stack that we're using at this customer, where we automated this. And in the end, as I mentioned, I will show you a quick demo how we did this automation and how it looks and feels like. The most important part of a DevOps lifecycle is probably your version control system. I mean, version control systems are out there for 30 years or even longer, starting with CVS many years back. Then I think all the starting about 2000 or 1995, we have a Subversion as one of the most important version control systems. And I think since even more than 10 years now, we have Git as the probably most commonly used tool to version your software artifacts. So how this usually works is it stores all your source code as text files. It especially allows you to easily see the diffs between those text files, how they evolved over time. And then one very important concept of Git is that you can have multiple branches where you usually have one branch for each new feature that you want to develop. So when you want to add maybe a new region to your Oracle Apex application, as we will see later on, then you usually start by creating a new branch for this new feature. You develop your application in this branch, maybe you test it even as a developer. And then once you're done, you merge this new feature branch into your main code line. And then from there on, put it to a testing system, run automatic tests against it, and later on eventually branch it into your production branch. So the main concept and the main difference probably that you see when using Git over Subversion is that it makes extensive using of branches. Even with Subversion, you were able to have branches, obviously, but with Git, it is way more widespread and people really use it a lot more with Git. Probably this is also the case because with Git, it works way better than with Subversion. I mean, for many of our customers, we were using Subversion as well. And some of them, especially if they were not so much used to Java development and were more old style 4GL developers, the customers quite quickly decided to get rid of all those branches in Subversion because they did so many errors when handling the Subversion branching process and especially the merging process that it was no real use. And this gets a lot better with Git and especially with the user interfaces for Git, the web-based user interfaces, the DevOps platforms that we will have a look at on the next slide. Without those web-based user interfaces, usually you interact with Git using the command line. I mean, there are some FAT clients for Windows and for macOS that can also help you to manage your Git repository, but usually you do most of the work at the command line interface and then have a web-based tool such as GitLab or GitHub Hub or also Visual Builder Studio, which we will see in a second, to manage your code together. And these tools such as GitLab and GitHub, they claim to be complete DevOps platforms. So they should help you in planning, in doing source code management, in running defining and running CI/CD pipelines. They have security integrated. So who is allowed to do what? Is really every developer allowed to do a merge to the production code line, which is then automatically deployed to production? Or do you need to have maybe a review there and only a handful of people being able to approve such changes, such merge requests? All this is functionality that you usually see in those DevOps platforms. The two most common widespreads we see at our customers are probably GitLab, which you can either get as a hosted environment from GitLab directly, or which you can also install on-premise. There's even a community edition that is very, very powerful that you can use to run your DevOps strategy on. And even the community edition is usually enough for most of the use cases. So GitLab is one of the big players in this field. A second one, the probably even bigger one, especially in the open source area, is GitHub, which is, I think, nowadays owned by Microsoft, and which is a purely cloud-based service where you can either have it as for open source projects, it's even free, or if you're in a commercial area, you can get a plan from them and have a private repository having all these features that you may use from the open source version from many of the open source projects that are nowadays hosted at GitHub. Both of the tools have the possibility to have CI/CD pipelines that are also part of the source code that means they are also versioned. So this is a very powerful tool. But also from Oracle, in the recent years, they started to develop a tool there as well, which is Oracle Visual Builder Studio Cloud Service. You need to look a little bit that there's the Oracle Visual Builder Cloud Service without the studio. This is just a develop. This is more a coding platform where you can define user or build user interfaces. And then the important part is the studio in the name here. And the studio is the what is previously named Oracle Developer Cloud, which is the tool that is kind of a DevOps platform. And as you may see in the screenshot on the left-hand side, is this Visual Builder Studio Cloud Service, previously named Developer Cloud, has most of the functionalities that you may know from GitLab and GitHub as well. So it has a Git repository integrated. It has a functionality to define and manage merge requests. It has Maven, NPM, and Docker repositories integrated. It has a builds capability where you can define jobs. This is what we will make use of later on in the demo, especially. Where you can also have jobs that deploy something to an Oracle database. Then you have artifacts for releases, for example. You can define environments. You have issues where you have an issue tracking system that you can then use to manage your issues and track your issues with the merge requests. And it also has kind of a DevOps board and a wiki where you can document, for example, how to use the tooling. So it's a quite powerful tool, and it is, from a functionality point of view, similar to what you will probably know from GitLab or GitHub. As I mentioned, you can also set up your CI/CD pipeline there using the UI, and it is quite easy to run shell scripts or SQL CL scripts from this pipeline. The tool itself is for free, at least if you have anything on OCI. So if you have maybe some databases from your OCI or even just compute instances from OCI, then you can just go to your OCI Cloud Console and tell Oracle to spin up a Visual Builder Studio Cloud Service. And then a few minutes later, you're able to access this. This is all integrated with the IDCS from the Oracle OCI. So you can manage your users through that. And yeah, basically everything is free. The only thing that may cost you money is if you want to run your pipeline, then your pipeline needs to run on some compute machine, probably within your own network with connectivity to your private network, maybe through a VPN tunnel. And to run this virtual machine that runs the builds, this is what Oracle charges for. But you can even use the free tier for this, or it's just a compute instance for, even if it runs all time, it is maybe $30 per month. So it's not much money, and it is automatically stopped whenever you do not use it. So the amount of money you need to spend is very minimal, and you can even do it in the free edition, then it does not cost anything at all. So this is one of the important tools that we were using. Another one is SQL CL, Oracle SQL Developer Command Line. This is SQL Plus in modern. So probably everyone working with an Oracle database, working with Oracle Apex, may know SQL Plus, and the Oracle SQL Developer Command Line SQL CL is kind of the successor of this tool. It is way more easy to use. It is more easy to install. It's just one zip file that you can download. You don't even have to agree to crazy license terms. You can just download it and unzip it and run it and connect to your Oracle database. And then it provides you capabilities, obviously, to run SQL commands, but it also has an scripting engine included where you can build JavaScript, for example, scripts that are then able to automate all those things. And one more thing that is powerful within SQL CL is that it has LiquiBase, which I will introduce on the next slide, just integrated. So you can just, from the SQL CL command line, run LiquiBase commands. Speaking of LiquiBase, LiquiBase is a tool that allows you to version control your database. I mean, usually versioning your database is a little bit more complicated than versioning just regular source code. Regular source code, you just write down Java files or whatever, and then you compile them, you run them. If you want to version a database and a database schema, and you're just talking about pure SQL source code, then things are similar trivial. You just install them into your database and then you're good. But the important thing about a database is obviously also storing data and having tables, and versioning tables is a little bit more complicated because usually you cannot just throw them away and replace them by a new version of the table, but you want to kind of maintain the data in your table. Maybe you have 100 gigabyte of data in your customer table with hundreds, thousands or millions of rows. Then whenever you want a new version of your tool, you don't want to start with an empty customer table, obviously. So you need to think about how can we manage the lifecycle of those tables especially. And Liquibase helps you doing this. So it kind of allows you to capture the current state of the table, which columns are there, which primary keys, which foreign key constraints, everything that you define as part of the database can be captured by Liquibase. Liquibase puts it into XML files describing the state of the database, especially of things like tables. And then you can extract this into an XML file. You can compare it to maybe a target database, and you can bring your target database up to the state of your XML file. And then what Liquibase does, it just checks which columns, for example, are missing, and then adds this column. Obviously, things are often not that trivial. Maybe if you want to change the data type of a column and you want to change it from a varchar text field to a number, then obviously you need to do more complicated things. And you can also do this with Liquibase by defining change sets where you have your custom scripts and maybe have something that creates a new column and migrates the data from your varchar column to your text column where it works, or there's some special handling for cases where you cannot convert. So you can also implement something like this using Liquibase. So primarily, Liquibase is about the metadata of your database, not the actual data. Yeah. So you would not usually use Liquibase to migrate the data from one instance to the other. You can do this, and I will show you in a second. It may be helpful for cases where maybe you have a lookup table with some configuration information, where you can also use Liquibase to migrate the contents of the table. But the primary focus is on bringing the metadata into sync between two instances. And then speaking about instances, obviously you need to have an Oracle database, especially for Oracle Apex. So you need to have infrastructure where you run your application, your database. And of course you can just run this on-premise or on compute of OCI and just create your database and your Apex as you have done it in the past 20 or 30 years. You can do it like this and then just access such a static instance from all your DevOps lifecycle. Or if you want to have something like one instance for each feature that you develop and for each Git branch maybe, then you can leverage of cloud, especially of Oracle Cloud Infrastructure, to more conveniently create such databases. And we will see at the very end of the session that it is very easy to also automate this and tell OCI, for example, to do a clone of your Oracle Autonomous Database. And maybe you have just your master database that is for testing. And then just with one command that I will show you at the end, you just clone the entire database. And 3 or 4 minutes later, you have a complete copy of your master database where you can then install your latest changes, your latest development source code, and run automated testing or continue your development. So cloud and OCI in specific can help you with all this. And you can either remote control these OCI databases by using OCI command line interface, or you can also use Terraform if your environments are even more complicated, where you can define your infrastructure as code and then just apply these Terraform definitions and with one click or with one command, make sure that you have an entire form of systems up and running, for example, with a database and multiple application servers and a load balancer in front of it. As we can define all this using Terraform, which is an open source product integrated in the OCI, and then with one command, for example, provision and a complete environment out of 10 or 15 servers. Terraform is a kind of cross-cloud platform, so it aims to have to be a little bit portable, at least between cloud vendors such as Oracle OCI or Amazon AWS or Google or Microsoft Azure. So Terraform helps you to automatically create or remove or modify infrastructure. We did not use it in our case because we just used the OCI command line interface, but if you have even more complicated infrastructure, Terraform might help as well. So this is the tool set that we were using at this customer. Let's have a look at the procedure that we have set up with this customer in order to implement such a DevOps lifecycle to especially automatically migrate our Apex applications from our development environment to our testing and production environment. So the process basically starts, it all starts with development, and we decided to just have one common development instance where all the developers are active, and that is shared. As long as everyone is working on the same project at one time, this is quite an okay approach. If you have multiple projects running in parallel, then you're probably better off by having dedicated databases, dedicated Apex application instances for each branch in your Git repository at least. I will show you at the very end how you can handle this even in an area where you have maybe a 5 terabyte database without having to multiply this 5 terabyte of data. But in a simple case, we just have one development project going on at one time, and that is done on our development database. Then at one time, we export the current state of the database, of the metadata especially, and also of all your PL/SQL packages and your Apex application, push it to Git, create then a merge request from development to our testing branch, where we see what has all changed, what is part of this release, this new feature that we developed. Then we merge this merge request into our testing code branch. And through that, we can automatically kick off a pipeline, what I will show you in a few seconds, that then updates our target environment, for example, our testing or even our production environment. So how can we implement those three steps? Exporting the database content, the database metadata especially, and your Apex schema is quite easy with SQL CL. So what you can do is you just go to maybe the database directory of your Git repository, you do a SQL CL connection to your database service, and then you just run a single command, which is lb for Liquibase, and then gin schema, which generates a Liquibase file or Liquibase files for the entire schema, and the minus split leads to not one large file being created or some all files being in the same directory, but to give you a little bit a more human readable form, where you have a separate folder for each type of objects, and then you have in your table folder, for example, for each table, you have an individual file. And then you just commit and push your changes to the Git repository, and you extracted the database schema. And what you then see is in your Git repository, your Liquibase always consists of a controller XML, which is just a simple XML file that contains all the objects that are part of the schema if you run the GAN schema process, so all the tables, all the packages, all the views, whatever you have. In this trivial sample, we just had a few tables or one table. Then you have a table folder, and within that table folder, we have an XML describing each table, describing all the columns of this table, the database, the primary keys, and so on. And Liquibase supports most of the functionality that the Oracle database supports. So even custom data types and all this stuff is possible to be controlled through Liquibase. So this is exporting the database schema. Then the next step is you need to export your Oracle Apex app. This works similar. So you can connect to your database using SQL command line, and then you can run the Liquibase generate object command for the type Apex, where you just define which Apex application do you want to export. You usually want to skip the export date so that not every export leads to a change where there is no change just because the export date changed. You usually also want to keep the original IDs of your application so that when you import the application in your target application, you just override it and don't create a new application over and over again. And then also here we have the split command, which splits the resulting file from one large file into many small files, one for each page or for each shared component or for each region, whatever. Yeah, so also this is very simple. If you run this, it just takes a few seconds to extract your entire application. And then again, it has a controller XML, and for each application, it has a folder F101 for the application 101. And then within that, it has an application folder. And within the application folder, you see the pages folder where you have all the pages and the short components and the themes and the user interface, which leads there. So it works quite conveniently. Unfortunately, right now, even with the 21.3 release of SQL CL, there are quite some bugs when it comes to the support of Liquibase and Apex. And that led for our project to the fact that we could effectively not use the Liquibase integration for SQL CL. However, this is not a really big problem, because SQL CL has, beside of this Liquibase approach of exporting an Apex application, it also has a way to just export natively an Apex application using SQL CL. You can just run the Apex export command without a Liquibase in front of it, and then you have more or less the same parameters. And what this does, it generates your SQL files instead of XML files. This is not really a drawback in my opinion, because I mean, you can always just install the entire Apex application to your testing or to your production instance and not just the changed objects, so that this is not really a big problem. But the Oracle SQL CL team promised that this will be fixed in the 21.4 version of SQL CL. Then you can also use the Liquibase approach. But for now, in this project where we used all this, we went for the standard SQL CL Apex export command, which just generates SQL files instead of XML files. Then, as I mentioned, you can also export data using Liquibase. For example, if you have some controlling data, maybe some lookup values or whatever, then you can extract the table content as well using the Liquibase data command. And also this leads to an XML file in a similar format. And using this, you can extract your entire application consisting of maybe some static seeded data out of your Apex application and out of the Oracle database schema. And then after this, you've extracted everything here into your custom branch, into your feature branch. And then using the Visual Builder Studio web interface, you can start or create a merge request where you merge your changes from your feature branch into your main testing branch. And using this merge request UI, you see exactly what has changed, which files were changed by whom, how many changes have there been. You can implement an approval process where someone needs to approve your change, that it can really go to your target branch. And you can also set up that not everyone is allowed to do such approvals, and that especially you are not allowed to maybe directly commit something to your main branch or to your production branch. And then after the merge request has been completed, you can set up and implement and run a pipeline that is maybe run on each command, on each commit to your testing branch, where you, in a simple case, maybe just run the three steps that we have seen previously to extract the data to the target system. You update the schema, you load some seeded data, and then you install the Apex application. Obviously, you can have more fancy operations as well, and maybe provision a dedicated environment first, then install everything there, and then maybe run some automated testing. And only after this step has been successful, maybe you want to install it to your main testing instance where your end users are accessing your Apex application. How do you implement this? You define a job within Visual Builder Studio Cloud Service that has multiple steps, in this case, three steps. The first step is you want to update or load the database changes, load the controller.xml that we created in the first step using the Liquibase update command, and just pass the change log, which defines the current state of your database. And then what Liquibase does is it checks what is already there in your database, what needs to be applied. Every change, every XML definition of the table, for example, has a checksum. And using that checksum, the Liquibase tooling can check in the database change log table if this change has already been applied. And if not, it kind of compares the data that is in your XML files versus the data that is in the database table, and then do the appropriate changes and maybe add another column or add another primary key or whatever you want to change. So this is all being done by Liquibase in the backend, and you don't really need to care about it. It just works. And as I mentioned, for most of the changes, it works quite good. Obviously, if you want to change a data type, the data type of a column from one type to another type that cannot be implicitly converted, you need to think about this. But I mean, in most cases, most of the changes are just we add another column or something like that, and that works really easy, and you don't need to think about is the column now already there on my testing instance or is it not there. So all these especially easy cases can easily be taken care of Liquibase. So this is the first step. The second step works similar, where we just load the data in our seeded table. We just tell Liquibase update and then with the data XML. And finally, we install the Apex application, either through Liquibase, where we just tell to load the Apex controller generated previously, or as long as the Liquibase support for Apex does not work 100%, we can just run the regular SQL file that we exported using SQL CL previously. And then if those steps are completed, we have installed our Apex application and can access the changed application. So let's have a look at how this works in real life. And I'm a little bit scared, so I was not brave enough to demo this live, but I have prepared some videos showing you the user interface, first of all, of Visual Builder Studio. So in Visual Builder Studio, first of all, we navigate to the issues tab. We create a new issue that we want to change something in our Apex application. We just give a title, a description. We can have all type of field. How much effort do we think this is? How critical is the issue? All these things that you will probably be aware of any issue tracking system that you know. And then the second step that I always prefer to do is create a merge request and create a branch for developing for this very easy. Early, our target branch is the test auto deploy branch. Whenever we commit something to this branch, as we will see later on, then it will trigger off an automatic deployment to our testing instance. And then we just give this new branch a name, for example, feature test, where we, through this step now create a new branch. We can decide who should review this merge request. Obviously, we can change this later on. We can link the merge request to an issue, for example, the issue that we just created. So then even when closing the merge request or merging the merge request, the issue can be updated automatically. And then we click create, and we have created a new branch in our source code management system, and we have created a merge request for this branch. So far, there has been no changes, no conversation, nothing in the branch, so nothing interesting. So now the next step is we look at this from our Git command line interface. So we just tell Git pull to get all the changes from our Git repository to our local development environment. And a few seconds later, hopefully, we see that there is a new branch now available upstream. We check out this new branch, the feature test branch, and switch to that new branch so that we are now working on the local repository. Obviously, we have no local changes so far, but now we have this branch also in our local development environment. So the next step is we go to Apex and we go to SQL Developer and just fix the issue that we want to fix. For example, we just want to change for demo purpose. We just may add a new field or new region to our Apex application. So we just open the application and create a new region and give the region maybe some title that it is for the test. And then we have changed our application on the development instance. And similar, maybe we want to change the some SQL packages. We might also want to change some database tables, but for sake of simplicity, we just add a comment to our package that resides within our database and just compile it using SQL Developer or whatever command or whatever tool you want to use to do your pure SQL coding. And what we have then implemented is kind of a little script that fetches everything from our development instance. I run this locally, but in the end, we have decided to run this even as part of our pipeline, so you can trigger the extracting of everything from the development instance, even as a job within Visual Builder Studio. But for now, I just run it on my local Windows machine, and I will share the script that we are running to extract everything in a second. It is basically the three steps that I've shown to you earlier. So we do a liquid-based generate schema that extracts all the types and the packages and the tables and the views and the sequences and whatever is in our Oracle database through this liquid-based generate schema command. When I did this, I had a very, very bad internet connectivity. That's why it took a little bit longer. But usually, even if you have a schema with maybe 1,000 objects, it takes maybe 30 seconds or minute maximum to extract all those metadata of those objects and update your local file system with the changed objects. In this case, with a better internet connectivity, and we had some 100 objects there, it took 27 seconds, the main step, to extract. And after this, we extracted the Apex application, the three or four Apex applications that are part of the workspace that is relevant here. As I mentioned, this is the entire script that we are using to extract everything. So basically, we run a SQL command script that does the liquid-based scan schema, and that does the Apex export, and eventually that does the liquid-based data command. And then, in order to avoid some issues the previous version of SQL CL has had with database link, we just revert the changes of the database link. I think with the 21.3 version of SQL CL, this hack is no longer necessary. And then also we revert the sequences, because this is also a little bit inconvenient of SQL CL. Whenever you run this export, it will update you the latest number fetched from the sequence. And obviously, you don't really want to have this in your database. So that's why on every extract, we just throw away changes in the sequences directory of existing sequences, because we usually do not change existing sequences. Maybe we add new ones, but we very seldom change existing ones. And that's why we just reverted those changes. So after you have done this, you can switch back to your Git bash and see what has changed. And as you can see, the extract that we have run, as a matter of fact, just changed three files. It changed something in the Apex application file. It changed something on page 00001, and it changed something in the package. And all the other hundreds of files that are part of our repository are not affected. So here you see what has changed. Somewhere the last update date changed, and the actual page changed, and we have this new comment. And there are thousands of other files in our Git repository that did not see any changes, because every extract works the same way. Then we can commit this to our branch. And I think first we need to add the change, obviously, in Git. And we edit, and then we commit it. I'm still too much used to subversion. And then we push the changes to our Git repository. And then we can have a look at the merge request from Visual Builder Cloud Studio in a second. There we can navigate to the merge request, which has now been updated 38 seconds ago. And we also there see what has been changed. We see three files have actually been changed. We see the date that has changed. We see the new region, and we see the new comment. And then we can approve that we want to merge this change, and through the merging in a second also trigger off, kick off a new build that deploys everything to our testing instance. That build is then run automatically, and we can go to the builds tab, and we see that a new build has run a few minutes ago. And then we can look into the log file of the build, and in the build log we see that the liquid-based commands and the Apex installation commands have been run to update our liquid-based database schema and to install the new Apex application. And then if you log into our testing instance, with the appropriate user, we will see that also the testing instance has been changed and got the changes that we developed previously on our development environment. So let's have a quick look how you define those builds. You can just go to the configure page of the build, and then we can see that we set up to check out the test auto deploy branch. And then we have three steps. The first step is to update the database metadata. The database schema itself is the packages and the tables. Then we update our data XML file with the seeded tables. And finally, we just run the install all SQL script, which just runs the install scripts of all our Apex applications and brings the Apex applications up to date. So this is for a regular, simple Oracle database in Apex. With eBusiness Suite, things get a little bit more complicated, mainly because of two reasons. The one thing is there is more than code that is part of the Oracle database. You have OR framework, you have forms, you have maybe even old style Oracle reports. You may have BI publisher, concurrent programs, and especially you have a lot of data. I mean, it is not unusual to have a database size of maybe 5 or 10 or 15 terabytes. And what you usually do in Oracle eBusiness Suite area that you copy the entire database if you want to create a testing or a development environment. So it is often obviously not convenient to have one instance for every developer, but you need to think about something else. And there are basically two approaches that we were using for our customers. The one is that we just share environments. So maybe we have a common, we have maybe just three Git branches, one for test, one for pre-prod, one for prod, and then maybe for one for development. And then all the developers share those instances. And when you run those export scripts, then obviously you need to look a little bit more, more detailed what to really extract. And what we did for this customer is that we have kind of a release driver that just names all the files that belong to this feature that we just want to change. And then we changed our scripts a little bit to just extract those objects and not extract everything. And then as long as the different developers are working on different parts of your Oracle applications environment, then this works quite good. When people work on the same source code, well, they should usually talk to each other. And our experience is that this also worked quite good, as long as you do not have too many people working on different projects in the same source code. If this is too much, then maybe it is a little bit difficult to handle. But you can then do, and what we did for these Apex portals that we implemented in front of Oracle Apex, is that we did a very loose coupling between the portals and the Apex that we have in the, for those portals and the database schemas of those portals. Those portals then connect to the Oracle Core eBusiness Suite database using database links and a proxy schema. And what we then did is that each developer, or at least each feature, got its own autonomous database. And each of those autonomous databases connected to the core eBusiness Suite through a database link. And then they could do at least all the development in their database schema, in their packages related to the portal and in the Apex application independent of each other. And only during merging, make sure that everything is fixing together. And then when it gets deployed to the shared development or the shared testing and the shared production instance, then there we have all the changes of all the features. And until then, in the early phases of development, each developer has its own instance. Yeah, you can easily automate this with a very short piece of code, which just does a complete clone of your master autonomous database as a create from clone. I've zoomed in a little bit, where you just need to provide what is the target name of the database, how big should the database be. You can even use the free tier for this. So then you can have two free development instances without having to buy an Oracle Autonomous Database. Then you get the wallet to connect to this database, and then you can just run your usual SQL scripts that we have seen previously to install your metadata and your Apex application to the target database. Yeah, so to summarize, I think using SQLCL especially and the Liquid base that is built in into SQLCL, it is really quite easy to set up a CI/CD workflow for Apex. You can use Visual Builder Cloud Studio, or you can also use GitLab, what we used for other customers because they had GitLab already in place. Now, I think all this procedure helps you to get better code into your testing and your production environment with less effort. So yeah, I can really just encourage you to use such a process over just developing a standard or a custom installation scripts and doing everything manually. So that leaves us maybe 5 minutes maximum for any questions. I can also try to look into the questions panel. There's nothing there.
There is nothing there. There is nothing in the chat window. So if you have questions, please write them or raise your hand and I can unmute you and ask the question.
Okay. Otherwise, if you have any questions later on, I can also share my email address. Don't hesitate to write me. I can definitely share some more details if you're interested in this. Also, kindly look at my blog, where I also have some more details. So if you just look for Promatis Michler and blog in Google, I forgot to put a link here, then you should also find it, and you find some more technical details on how we did this also with progressive web applications, for example, for Apex. Okay, then thanks for joining. And
thank you.
Enjoy the rest of the day.
Thank you so much.